Welcome back to Mid-Mornings on Maine on this Tuesday, 27th day of April. Wow, what a beauty. I mean, this is spectacular weather we're enjoying today. It's a kind of day that makes you want to get out and drive around, and maybe you're thinking about purchasing that new home, or you're looking for business property, investment property, and you look at it today, it might look really good today, about as good as it could, but New York City. We have a gentleman who could probably tell us how to invest in New York real estate today if we may ask him that. We're really glad to have Sidney Potter, who is the author of Broker, but more than author of the book. I mean, he's a guy who has been in major market real estate business for a good number of years now, a couple of decades, and he's going to give us the skinny on what is happening in the real estate world, and so pleased to have Sidney Potter with us. Good morning, Sidney.
Mr. Manley, thank you very much. It's great to be out there in sunny Kentucky, Lexington.
And you're in Raleigh, North Carolina today, but you, where haven't you been? In the last 5 years, what state haven't you been in?
Maybe only a third. Ever since the crash, and in fact, I wrote a book on it called The Essayist. It was a Jack Koryak type of book where I traveled to different states and talked about the aftermath of the crash. But at least a third of the states in the last 10 years. I happen to be in Raleigh, North Carolina, doing some mortgage op real estate advisement work, even though I call Pasadena, California my home. And I've been through your great state. My grandpa was born in Louisville and was actually a horseman. So I've been through Kentucky as well.
Yeah, but where did you grow up most of the time?
Sure, Southern California, in particular. There's a city there called Culver City. Your listeners may or may not know it. It's where a lot of movies are shot. It's not too far from Burbank. Lots of studios out there. So that was there in the 70s, Culver City, California, which is known as Southern California.
Yeah. As you have moved around, though, as you've seen people, did being there in Culver City, did that really shape your lifestyle in a certain way? And as you have gone through life and watched and examined as other people in other places and how they lived and how they reacted to things, from the base of Culver City, has your personality changed much as you have moved around from that base that you got there?
Culver City is a good microcosm, at least it now was, back in the 70s of America today. There was some social demographic changes that were going on. You had an elite part, if you want to call it that, that were part of the movie business that were transitory within themselves. But it was transitioning in terms of Culver City, even though it's the West Coast, used to have something called sunset laws. And sunset laws means you really shouldn't be out after dark if you happen to have dark skin. I know that's probably very foreign to hear that type of editorial on a West Coast city, but it was fairly implicit. When I was growing up, we were a bunch of kids that were black, white. We had some Asians in there as well, and of course, the Latin Americans. And everyone got along together great. It was more like a sports type of locker room in the sense that no matter where you came from, if you could perform on the field, you were in. You see more of that today in terms of a cosmopolitan perspective from coast to coast and middle America. They call it flyover, but it's just as important because it keeps both the ends binded together. But you do see more of that actual mixing between ethnicities and also just a more cultural appreciation, which would probably be a nice way of putting it, of different cultures. And then I think what we go to is the present day woke society, for better or worse, that we now find ourselves in. But I felt it was normal. I didn't know at the time that it was somewhat unique, but it's a great little city. It's probably 10 to 10 miles away from Pasadena, California, which is where I now reside, but it's a wonderful little community.
Yeah, everybody knows Pasadena, right? I mean, you know.
Yeah, parade.
The parade. Did you ever work on the parade?
No, but, you know, it's the first time I saw a B-51, or rather a stealth flyover. That was in 92, I think, about 30 years ago. Never participated in the parade, but certainly viewed it a couple times right there. Went right down on Colorado Boulevard about two blocks from where I lived.
Mm. What would give someone like you growing up the thought that in what has had to be just a tremendously competitive world to go into real estate?
I think that those who go into real estate, either they be male or female, and either it be in residential brokerage or commercial brokerage, which is what the broker is about. It's about my time as a commercial real estate broker with Marcus & Millichap, a national brokerage, would go into either one of those two industries, either commercial or residential, probably have an inherent sense of wonderment. They're typically folks that like to roll up their sleeves, get out, don't want to be confined to a 9-to-5, want to go out there and kick the tires, and have a potentially an opportunity to make quote-unquote unlimited income, whatever that is. But most of those that get into brokerage want to make good money, want to call the shots, and want the opportunity to have a little bit of variability in their life besides just going to a 9-to-5. So that's what propelled me. It's what my father's been licensed since 65, still holds a current license with the California Department of Real Estate. That's why he got in the business in his early 20s and made a great 30-year career out of it. But I think that would probably encapsulate as to why those who want to go into either commercial or residential brokerage.
I've always sensed that real estate is an industry, and for anybody that's in the industry, there is a duality that happens, and that is that you work really, really hard to get some business, and then occasionally something kind of falls out of the sky for you. And for the people that are successful and ongoing and have long careers in it, you got to have both. That you can't just sit around and wait for everything to fall out of the sky. And you might not make it if you had to work as hard as you work for some things, but when you get that combination and good things happen. Is that
partially so. I mean, listen, if any commission-based position is not for the passive or for the faint of heart, you've got to have some degrees of alpha male or female within you. You've got to be self-motivated. You will wash out very quickly. That typically tends to be a psychomatic profile or psychometric profile in terms of if you look at certain types of characteristics in an individual and you have to score them on a matrix, that tend to be propelled towards sales positions. Now, commercial real estate brokerage, real estate in general, is not all sales. There are administrative positions as well. It's probably tantamount to being behind the camera in movie land as opposed to being in front of the camera. You need the busybodies to make it work. But when you talk about commission-only brokerage sales, commercial or residential, it takes a certain profile to fit. And, you know, something that I talk about, they're not all, you know, Glenn Ross, which was a screenplay by David Mamet, played in Broadway in the 90s, Alex Baldwin eventually was in the movie, about alpha males. There's lots of, you know, girls do brokerage too, and they kick ass along the way. Pardon me for my language, Mr. Manley. But it's for those that want to succeed and make an unlimited amount of money. You've got to be, in today's day and age, just to move around here a little bit, with all the social media, you have some that will think they can get into either or, commercial or residential, by simply online social media marketing. That's a bit of a booster shot. It certainly helps, but at the end of the day, you've got to have the ability. Either you be a very mellow person, I know a lot of accountant types that made a good living, are more alpha males or very aggressive females that have the ability to withstand rejection, okay, and have the ability to get up each and every morning. Because like you had indicated, Mr. Manley, there are times where things drop out of the sky and happen very suddenly, and you've got to be able to react. You've got a pocket listing. You've got a commercial property, strip retail, that's going into foreclosure. The ownership could be a small family LLC, wants to sell very quickly before the NOD, notice of default, hits the airways. And then you start to then definitely see the vultures move around your property, and that's an automatic devaluation. So there are things that happen very quickly where you'll have lots of successes, lots of highs, and certainly lots of lows.
Oh, you mentioned, when you mentioned Glenn Ross, I'm thinking, wow, goodness, Al Pacino, Alec Baldwin, Ed Harris, Alan Arkin, Kevin Spacey.
Yeah.
I don't want to be in the same room with that bunch.
No.
Wow, that's that was a scary cast. I thought, not necessarily individually, but boy, you put all that group together, and
boy, what you talk about dynamics too, and I that's one of the few movies where I've seen more than six times, and that was released. I saw that my dad, of all people, obviously told me to go see it because he owned his own commercial real estate brokers in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And it was just an incredible movie, incredible dynamics. I talk a little bit about the dynamics about men with lost souls, without a moral foundation, those that have done well and not done well, and scheme against good friends and foe. It's got such a dynamic there, and also with Jack Lemmon, that's a name that you forgot, who is a different type of personality schematic. This was just very riveting. I think, and I have to say that was Alex Baldwin at his best. I worked around guys like that were just ruthless and smile you one moment, give you a wink and stab you the next moment. You went to go get them a cup of coffee, and if you're ever in a brokerage environment getting some. A cup of coffee, you probably didn't deserve to be there.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a great movie. I'm glad you mentioned it.
We see the real estate world here in Kentucky, and what prices are going up significantly. Mm-hmm. Real estate at the same time, because of interest rates are where they are.
Mm-hmm.
It's like everybody is kind of benefiting. If I'm selling, I'm making more money. If I'm buying, I still can afford more than maybe I could have under most circumstances because of interest rates, and that's good and everything. But on a more national basis, does that trend really, hang across the country, or are you seeing some different things in different areas?
There's about 360 to 380. It's almost like the difference between a country or a territory, but about 380 MSAs, which are metropolitan statistical areas. And that's the indice that measures the variability and volatility and stability of real estate markets, commercial and residential. For the most part, in terms of an affordability index, things are going up. Affordability index is going to be applicable to the buyer, meaning whether or not it makes sense to own this commercial property or home. Before the crash, you saw a lot of the high-end markets, San Francisco, New York, reach a point of implosion earlier than the middle markets, only because they were so leveraged and they were at the tipping point. So when things were going to go wrong, those that were over-leveraged were going to experience the most immediate pain. Everything is going up for the most part. I wrote an article 3 months ago on what the 2021 outlook was going to look like. And in terms of commercial brokerage, this goes for small shops as well, small little strips, 5,000 square feet that may have a dry cleaners and a 7-Eleven at the corner, or a Circle K, depending upon which part of the country you're from. You find that those markets are going up. Part of the problem here is whether or not they'll be able to sustain that type of growth. And something that the commercial brokers are running into is that warehouse, type facilities, trucking facilities, anything to do with transportation are doing wonderfully well. And of course, that's very obvious because there's a bit of a hoarder mentality in terms of stocking up from toilet paper to canned goods because of the plague. You find other commercial aspects, and I wrote about this, that are doing just exceptionally terrible. That's office space. Seems like everybody's commuting these days, working remotely. And you find retail spaces. The aforementioned dry cleaners. People don't really need to get their clothes dry cleaned as much as possible. And corner liquor stores. But you find that the retail spots aren't doing as well because most folks are staying in and aren't going to those restaurants. By extension, that means that the commissions are down. And a primarily commission-orientated environment, that's going to hurt those type of commercial brokers. On the other hand, if we can switch and pivot a little bit to residential, if you've got a good book of business and you've been working the phones, let's say you got in the business 5 years ago or 15 years ago, and you've got warm leads, you should be able to matriculate those into closings, either they be on the buy side or sell side. And it seems to be hitting all market product in terms of the schematic from, you know, the 100, well, that's a little too low, but I'd say the $250,000 homes all the way up to several hundred thousand on up in terms of who's having the activity on the residential side in terms of buying or selling.
Mm. Our guest is Sidney Potter. He's author of The Broker. It's not his first book, but it's a new look at what's happening in the real estate world, and things have changed a lot, I think. And I wonder if you think that most people are going to view this book. If for people that are in the real estate world, Sidney, will they read this book, and will it, you think they'll say, okay, that reinforced a lot of the things that I thought, or will they get a lot of shock value here? Will there be a lot of moments when they'll be reading things and they'll say, my goodness, I hadn't thought about that. I had no idea. Which do you think, or is it just a kind of a mixture of the two?
If you look at the reviews, you know, they really they focused a little bit on the shock value, but then they said at least Mr. Potter had the decency to have a fairly generous index in terms of real estate terms. It's 418 pages. It's not, you know, an easy read. You know, you wouldn't want it to do it in one evening. It's a little mixture of everything. There's some very short stories in there, chapters that are 6 to 7 pages long, and then some that are 30 to 40. And it's primarily, I suppose, if you had to, you know, hybrid vehicles don't typically work. They seem to have caught on now. I would say this is a bit of a hybrid book in terms of real estate, but a lot of backstory in terms of growing up in Southern California, Culver City in particular, changing neighborhoods from black to white and everything above or below, with no sense of judgment, and one person's journey on following the footsteps not only of his grandfather on his maternal side out of New Haven, Connecticut, that being my mother, Mary Carol Kaufman, but also my father, who got in the business of commercial brokerage as a black man in Southern California, and particularly set up shop in South Central, Los Angeles. So there's a lot of stories on what it, from at least a kid's perspective, on what commercial brokerage is, to eventually working in a Glengarry, Glen Ross type of environment downtown Los Angeles with Marcus and Milichak, wherein the, I wouldn't call it a protagonist, but the main mover of the story through his eyes, his perspective, was in running for the Rookie of the Year. So this is the set, the milieu, if I can set it for you, in terms of kidhood to adulthood, and just seeing an incredible amount of stories like we all do, because there's a thousand stories out there. I'm the first one to say that, but it's that person's interpretation of the world as the child of a black father and a white Italian Jew out of New Haven, Connecticut, whose father went to Yale. And there's just an aggregation of thought process that goes through the perspective on determining what he thinks is right and wrong. So if you're looking for some brokerage stories, there's a lot of good short brokerage stories. It may seem very fraternity-like in a way, which can have some gross aspects about it, depending upon how you look at it. But I think it's an enjoyable read, and those that have commented on the book fortunately thought so as well.
It's you're a cosmopolitan person, aren't you? I mean, you that's we talk about cosmopolitan cities, and you're a cosmopolitan person.
Well, you know, like yourself, and I suppose most everyone, happy to be here. If you really have a sense of wonderment and appreciation, and typically don't find a bad bone in another person, which I typically don't, unless otherwise stated, I enjoy the travel, meeting different people, characters, observing, typically without contempt or apprehension. I think in my world, everyone starts a perfect 100, and you can only work down. And I suppose there's some extra credit you can do if you've sinned, you know, and things don't look too good in terms of your character profile. But I tend to have a genuine view of people, and I think that's somewhat shaped by the ability to travel multitude of states last 20-plus years going on at this point.
Worst-case scenario, what happens in the New York City real estate market?
You know, there. New York, and I worked in Brooklyn 2 years ago, Chinatown on Fifth Avenue. They got the best raisin buns out there. New York is a great place to visit. I would not want to live there, especially in the winter. I mean, the trash piles up. There's a good reason there's not smell-o-vision, like panoramic vision, CinemaScope. New York was just awesome, and you know, I was reading about the brokerages. About 4 or 5 months ago, and it's incredible. But it's the walk-ups are great. Okay, these are 100-plus year properties. If you own right there, you're probably not too happy because there's a cap on the income flow. You've got 1,000 square foot walk-ups, okay, that are netting 1,300 because they've got rent control when they should be netting 4,000. So owners, depending upon when they bought and whether or not their tenants are grandfathered into lower rates, are hurting, okay? But it's a great write-off because you have some depreciation. So it depends how you look upon it, quite frankly, when you bought and whether or not you're subject to current laws. New York, in particular, NYC is a pretty liberal state, so in some aspects it's not business friendly, but if I had the opportunity, then there'd be no reason for it because I'm not a tri-state guy between Jersey, New York, and Connecticut. It would be a wonderful place to have current ownership, I would say.
Really, you'd be a buyer of New York City real estate right now?
Well, I would be buying in the distressed areas, the C locations, not mid Manhattan and A.
Yeah.
I think that those are, when you look at historical highs, are very aggressive. I mean, you know, in terms, you know, what I recommend to residential buyers and also commercial buyers, Zillow does a great thing in their competitive websites by showing, and there's been class action lawsuits on this, will show its historical highs and lows in terms of its last transfer date, what the price was, and if you've got a 30-year graph in front of you, then there's five to six, half a dozen transfers, property transfers, you can get a sense of whether or not you're buying at the high and low. For the most part, with probably 95% certainty, it probably won't go that much more than its previous high unless you look over a 10-year trajectory. So that it's a good way to cheat, but it's permissible cheating in terms of knowing where you're buying at the market. So I would say, and listen, there become more sophisticated, complex reasons buying. Some people like, and our investment entities like buying things that are highly priced, that have what they call a low capitalization rate or a low cap rate, because they like to park their money there. They can afford to take the loss. It's one of the big reasons why for some Fortune 500 companies don't pay a substantial amount of federal income or federal tax because there's such a loss of other entities they have and are subject entities or intellectual property that loss in turn decreases the taxable income. So as you know, it's an enviable place to position to be to buy something very expensive and not mind that it's appreciating. But the reason at least the exchange on the lack of appreciation would be the depreciation that you can take to lower your overall corporate taxable income. So that's a more sophisticated, nuanced level. One should only be so lucky to buy something very expensive and not really care that it appreciates, but there are different reasons. But on the normal people scale, most people like to buy low and sell high. That still holds true today.
People in the real estate people in the hinterlands, what are they going to get from this book?
I think it depends upon your age, quite frankly. If you're 17, 18, 19 years old, you're in live in middle America, and say, gee, I'd love to be a work for a hedge fund. I'm not going to be able to do it in the flyover states, although it's critical to our existence in America that midsection exists. It's going to make your mind think, quite frankly. Before I went to college, I would go to the library and say, gee whiz, what do I want to do? And this is when Michael Melkin was really big in the early 80s, and everyone wanted to, work for a hedge fund or junk bonds or something like that, and the default on that was commercial real estate or some type of brokerage, stock brokerage, where the entries, barriers of entries are pretty low. You get license, Series 7 license, or a real estate license. You either go into stock bonds or stock brokerage or commercial brokerage. So I think if you're at that teenage or early 20s and you're thinking of a career, you're thinking, wow, this is dynamic. I'm not a 9-to-5 guy who's going to work well in an office. I think if you're 20 to 30, 40 years older than that, you'll get out of it. I don't want to say how the other half lives, but it's how a different subset of a society lives in terms of a career and what they go through. And I think most people like to live a little bit voyeuristically through the eyes of others. That's what makes movie scripts and sells books.
And it's safe to say that that understanding the bigger picture of what's going on in the real estate world in larger markets, it'd be real easy for people in smaller markets dealing real estate to cast off and say, oh, I don't need to know about that. But knowing about that, even if they're not dealing directly in those markets, has to be of great benefit, I would think.
Of course it is. It shows you the ecology of property. What's the building that you go to work at, or that you operate your business, or that you visit. They have rent rolls, they have taxes, insurance. It gives you an evolutionary look at the from nuts to bolts, cradle to grave of how this real estate schematic feeds itself, and the food chain in terms of those that make a living, and how important it is to the economy too. We found out in the crash in 2008, and I wrote about it in the flip, that there's interconnectedness to everything, almost, from a single mom who has to drop her kid off at a preschool, which is located in a commercial building, potentially, maybe just one story, strip center, whatever. Okay, that there's interconnectedness, and it makes it a little bit more, I think, fascinating, three-dimensional, to view the world around you when you read about something that you may have not known about, to answer the question.
Again, the name of the book is The Broker. And marketing standpoint, during this time period, are you getting to where you're able to travel a little more now and get out and promote this book?
For the flip and for the essayist, we did or could have done, we had the typical book signing, bookstore appearances. Obviously, you can't really do that nowadays, although maybe you kind of could. So it's nothing that I would appear in person with. And, you know, if you talk to publicists out there, they're not getting that demand because it just doesn't kind of make sense. So, you know, I like book review on C-SPAN. I've been watching that for 20 years. I'm seeing less programming that way. But there are other ways that writers out there are getting the word out, and it's primarily through the Zoom, Skype type of angle to have discussions in a Brady Bunch type of way where people are boxed out and you see their faces when they talk about a book. So there's still ways to get the word out there. There's still a thirst, you know, for knowledge. Either it be a cookbook or a memoir from an athlete. People, fortunately, in an advanced society, have a need to learn, and I see that going on. And I'm happy to talk about the broker. Anything related to real estate, Mr. Manley, you could set me in front of a redwood with a with a glass of wine or a cold brew, and I'm good, man. I'm good. I can talk real estate and politics all day long.
The flip, the essayist, the broker, certainly books that people who are well, we're all in the real estate business to some extent, aren't we? I mean, everybody in America at some level is in the real estate business. Even the homeless are trying to find that little spot where they can drop a tent. So, certainly people that are serious about the real estate business and really want to understand what's going on. I think that one of the things that we run the risk of is if you kind of bury your head in the sand exactly where you are and discount what's going on in other locales in America, you can run the risk, because we're all in this thing together, and what's happening in other places at some point in time likely will roll around and will impact us in certain ways, hence the great value of these three books to the general population, really.
Good enough. Mr. Yeah. Manley, thank you.
Yeah. That's and what's next? What are you actually doing these days? I mean, when you tell me you're in Raleigh, North Carolina, you know, what's an LA guy doing in North Carolina these days?
Yeah, this is my second time out here. I was out here in Charlotte, North Carolina about 10 years ago doing some work for a consulting firm. Doing mortgage operations work, for sure. Working on my next book, for sure. And enjoying Raleigh. Because it's state capital, I can see it from the apartment I have. I'm on the 15th floor of an awesome newly built, C.B. Richard Ellis building, and I can see the capital, from here. And Raleigh is kind of like the Austin, Texas, I would say, of North Carolina, meaning the politics are a little bit different. It's somewhat contentious, which gives it a little bit of energy. So because of that, it's nice to be here at the epic center of the great state of North Carolina and the state capital, because it's a capital city, Raleigh, very historic. So been here for about the past year when lockdown went. I got an apartment, doing some work out here, and waiting to get back to California eventually, probably in the next 6 or 7 months.
Okay. Hey, well, if you flip that coin, heads Carolina, tails California, you're going to hope, you really would hope it would be tails and you get back to California, wouldn't you?
Yeah, man, maybe to a new governor, if we can do a little politics right here, sir.
Oh, you think we might have a new governor out there?
They're
moving in that direction.
Yeah.
Hey, well, best of luck to you. I had a nephew that was teaching in California one time, and he left because he was a Midwesterner,
yes.
and he looked up one day in a class of 32, he was teaching like 13 different languages, and he didn't know 13 different languages.
Yeah,
and it's kind of different places have problems, mm-hmm. And good things, yeah. that we don't know about. No, I mean we're oblivious to a lot of the good and a lot of the bad that's going on all over this country, and you've kind of shed some light on some areas for a lot of people through these books, and best of luck to you. Thanks a lot for being with us.
Thanks for your time. Have a super rest of the day.
Yeah, you too. Don't go away. We've got more to come, more virtual talk on the Derby coming up, and no more guests coming in after the top of the hour. Stay tuned.
The finest thing around. whispers something soft and kind. Hey, baby, the sky's on fire, I'm dying, need I? Upon